Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for convening this very important hearing. Like many of my colleagues, I also support the Future Act, which will provide industry with the incentives they need to for widespread implementation. I'm a proud sponsor of CCUS because I've seen firsthand how effective this technology can be in bringing economic and environmental benefits. Decatur, Illinois, in my home state, is home to Archer Daniels Midland, a project that began capturing carbon dioxide from an ethanol production facility in April of 2017. This project can capture up to 1.1 million tons of CO2 per year, which is sequestered in a nearby deep saline rock formation. So from power plants to industrial facilities to oil operations, there's obviously tremendous opportunities to deploy CCUS. And I believe we must invest and prioritize CCUS so that we can maintain our leadership in the energy sector as well as realize its tremendous job growth potential. Dr. Friedman, can you please share the economic development potential associated with wide-scale implementation of CCUS, not just here in the U.S., but also for us to sell or deploy this technology abroad as well?
Thank you. It is clear to me that there are large opportunities for deploying CCS in the United States and in the North America market, including Canada and Mexico, which are seriously chasing CCS and looking for projects and partners. The market opportunity and the job opportunities in that are very large. I've seen a number of commercial estimates that suggest that by 2025, this could be a $6 billion market in the United States with the appropriate policy structures. I think, however, the big opportunity is the international market. I have had the good fortune of representing our country in negotiations and discussions with China, with India, with Japan, with Australia, with South Africa, and with many countries in Europe. They are aware that they are not going to hit their climate targets without CCS either. They're a bit reluctant to take it on up front, a bit the way that my children are reluctant to clean their room. But ultimately, my children have to clean their room, and these countries know that they have to do that work as well. Right now, it is still the case that the United States can develop and lead the world in deploying and marshaling that technology, and that is an export opportunity that is immense, many hundreds of billions and trillions of dollars of total revenues.
And so if we don't invest in its development here in the U.S., are other countries poised to take over? Should we not develop and be the ones to provide the CCS technology abroad with this market potential? If we don't do it, is somebody else going to step in and provide the service?
Unquestionably, and a number of countries are very aggressive on that front. The most obvious is Norway. Since 1993, Norway has had a carbon tax. They are the global leaders in carbon capture technology. They have the technology center Mongstad, which they are using to test technologies from around the world, and they have their own state-sponsored research programs and commercialization programs to get that technology out. Aker Clean Carbon and Statoil are, in fact, actively competing in this space. Next in line, I'd mentioned Canada. But in fact, and that is an important actor, but probably the one to keep an eye on, not surprisingly, as always, is China. Japan has put a lot of money into this, and in fact, Dr. Greason's plant is in fact using this Japanese technology because that was the market beater at the time. But China is dumping an awful lot of money into centers of excellence on everything from geological storage to material science to supercomputing. And they are fielding large projects and demonstration now for the first time ever. Xi Jinping is clearly making commitments to accelerate their current commitments beyond the Paris commitment, and CCS is one of the things that they can do. They are able to lay out tariffs, declare projects, marshal thousands of engineers at the drop of a hat, and are very much looking at this technology space for the global lead position.
So they have a clear national, they have clarity in their national policy in investing in this technology. And I'm not one to, you know, support red tape for the sake of red tape, but I think that with CCS, I think there's a different challenge for businesses here in the U.S. that want to make these investments. I think we failed to send a direct signal to business indicating that we take the threat of climate change seriously. And with that, we don't have a clarity in our national energy policy that would set up the goals, the support. And so businesses are probably, you know, if we don't have a national policy the way the Chinese do, then people are going to be reluctant to get into the industry?
If we are going to be competitive in that race, we have to run faster. And the way that you get the team to run faster is to incent them. Okay. There are many, many different ways to do that, but you need to send that signal and you need to make it big enough so that companies will commit the capital and the staff and the human beings and all the rest of it to really make it work.
Thank you. I'm out of time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Duckworth.